What's up, everyone? Welcome to the Student Built Startups Podcast. I'm your host, Cameron Stone, entrepreneur and marketing analytics student at UMD. I interview student entrepreneurs to share their stories and business strategies. Today's guest will speak about creating content and marketing. He has plenty of experience in this arena from working in marketing roles in multiple successful companies, as well as building his side hustle using marketing and content creation. He'll be sharing his story and how his education has played a role in it. I encourage you to go check out AK3 Marketing on Instagram and Facebook. I'm excited to introduce you all to the owner of AK3 Marketing and Steel Bodies University, Jared Dent. Well, Jared, I'm happy to have you here on the Student Built Startups Podcast. Hope you're doing great today. I'll have you start off by saying hello to everyone listening and sharing one crazy but true fact about yourself.
Hey, everybody. I'm Jared Dent. I'm the guest here today. Something interesting about me, maybe something a little strange or whatever. I don't know. I'm interested in, I just recently got interested in like quantum physics. You probably like, what the heck is that? quantum physics, like, that sounds like some kind of geeky thing. But, you know, it's just pretty much... for instance, the last thing I learned about was like mirror neurons. And it's pretty much like we tend to act upon like what we see. So like, for instance, Kobe Bryant, the late Kobe Bryant just passed away.
Yeah.
He idolized Michael Jordan so much that he studied him so much that Michael Jordan's game became his game because he studied it so much and those mirror neurons activated to where, okay, now you are Michael Jordan. So, you know, that's one thing that aspiring entrepreneurs, they can do. That's actually some advice that I have for you is to look and study people that have actually done it. And, you know, eventually you'll start to kind of, you'll start to notice that you start to move like them a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then the crazy thing is you'll start to like see results. So, you know, it sounds weird. It sounds crazy, but it's a real thing.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. I hadn't really heard about like what quantum physics were, but Based on your brief little explanation, it sounds like something very valuable to kind of get some insights from.
It's pretty much like the gist of it is pretty much like the study of the unseen, like the stuff that you can't see. If you were someone to like read it and like you're very impressionable or like you're like intrigued on stuff that is like out of the ordinary, like you would like these kind of that particular subject.
Yeah, some very deep thinking topics, it sounds like.
Exactly.
All right. Well,
it's good for mental exercises, man.
Yeah. It seems like it. Well, if you start off here with sharing a little bit about your education and your entrepreneurial story, including some of the details about your business, AK3 Marketing.
Just to start with the general background, I have my bachelor's degree from Cal State Fullerton. I'm in California, so that's one of the state schools here. I got my business degree, concentration in marketing. A few years after that, I went and I got my master's degree, also my MBA in marketing from University of Redlands. So my schooling has totally been in marketing. After that, I went into, I always had kind of like a hustler's like mentality. So like during college, I would do like certain jobs that were like, you know how you would go online and you'll see like we're looking for a person that has the entrepreneurial spirit, or if you're a self-starter, this job is for you. Like I would always like gravitate to those type of jobs or like commission based jobs where you were paid like based off of merit, not like off of the hours you worked or whatever. So I always knew I wanted to work for myself or like be like in control, like be the boss. So I say it was about 2012. That's like when the fitness game had kind of like really started to kind of like take off a little bit.
Yeah.
And I teamed up with a couple of guys. We had started doing like free like fitness workouts. And we would get like large groups of people there, and then we would sell them like supplements. So we would get them there, work out for free, and then we would sell supplements or whatever. So during that time, like it kind of slowed down a little bit. And then I got the idea, like, you know what? I'm going to do this on my own, and I call it Steel Bodies University. So that's my personal training program that we like briefly talked about beforehand. So I took that same model, but what I did was, okay, I'm going to actually charge the people to work out, and then I'll give them extra stuff for free. So I did it like the opposite way around.
Yeah.
Because one thing you'll notice is like when you give people stuff for free, they kind of don't value it as mm-hmm. much. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah, so for sure.
I charge the people to work out, and then I will give them free like sweaters or like, you know, just give them like free like meal plans or yeah. like free workouts to do like on the days that we don't meet and all that kind of stuff like that. So I worked that I've been doing that since 2013, and kind of jumping around a little bit. You guys just heard, I got my background in marketing. So sports and marketing, those are my two, like, those are the two things that I love to do. So I married the two.
Yeah.
And I grew my sports business by actually, obviously, marketing it, creating the content, the videos, you know, doing blogs and stuff like that. And, you know, I got to a point there where I kind of got to a point where I was like, okay, I can now move into something else because I gained a lot of valuable experience doing marketing, not only doing my own personal training business, but, you know, I had a job too, a 9-to-5 job. Like, so I had school, I had job, and I had my side hustle, which is my training. So all of that together, I learned how to become an efficient marketer. So people would always tell me, like, why don't, like, you have a master's degree, like, why don't you use your master's degree or whatever? And I was like, to myself, like, why don't I use my master's degree? Like, what the hell are they talking about? Like, what do you mean? Like, you use my, like, it's just a piece of paper, right? Like, like, I'm like, what do you mean? Use it? Like, do I go like running around saying, hey, I got a master's degree, dude? Like, you know, let me do your marketing. So I thought about it, and I was like, one day it kind of like just came to me, like, oh, use my master's degree. Like, dude, I'm just going to become a marketing consultant, right? Because, you know, I did the research and all that kind of stuff. Like, marketing consultants, like, they pretty much, you know, have master's degrees. I got that. They make anywhere between like 50 to 70 grand a year. Like, I make that. Like, I hit like all these qualifications or whatever. So I'm like, okay, well, I'm going to do that. And then that's when I did, that's when I formulated my AK3 marketing consulting business, say about 8 months ago now. So I've been doing that. It's still in its infancy stages, but you know, I've built it to a good place where I have some sort of revenue coming in. Obviously, I have grander plans for it. It's just starting out now, but the scaling process is in full swing. So you know, I'm doing my sales, I'm doing my consistent marketing, I'm doing my advertisement, and you know, it took a while for me to start like making some type of money off of it, which is okay, because I already knew that was going to happen from my previous experience of doing my first business or side hustle or business or whatever you want to call it. So I really didn't care about that. I just really focused on creating the content, marketing, so people know that I exist. And then obviously, you know, when people begin to trust you and see like the work that you do, they'll start to spend money with you. So I'm at that phase now. I'm starting to make a little bit money. So now I'm going to start to begin to scale. I'm going to start to accelerate that process a little faster.
Yeah, for sure. Sounds like you're putting in the grind.
yeah, man. It's really tough. But that's part of why I like, you know, entrepreneurship. Yeah. Like, it's really challenging. It's really hard. And one thing about when I work and when I have jobs or whatever, I get bored like after like 6 months, you know what I'm saying? Like a year. And I'm like, okay, I don't want to do this no more. I'm going to just go back to working for myself again. You know what I'm saying? So, luckily I've been able to, like, you know, in the past I was, you know, was able to do so, but it's all about, you know, for me anyway, not only like financial freedom, but just like personal, you feel your personal freedom, dude. Like, you can wake up when you want to, you can take your kids to school, you can go to their T-ball games, you know, you can do all this kind of stuff without having somebody tell you like, I know we need you to come to work today. That's my driving force into doing that, into growing a business and sustaining a business. So you don't have to go back to that. Not saying that there's anything wrong with it, because you have to work to get the experience.
Kind of what I like to say is that, like, entrepreneurship, it gives you the ability to do what makes you fulfilled, because you don't really have anybody else telling you what to do. You kind of target what makes you feel the best, and then you can go and do that and spend the majority of your time doing what you like most.
Right. Exactly. Yep. You got it. You have it, man. You have it.
So what was, like, the biggest thing that inspired you to go down the entrepreneurial path? Like, what was the biggest inspiration that you had?
Pretty much that, dude. That? That was it. Like, I got to a point, like I said, I always, like, from my early 20s, like, I always felt like, okay, I want to be in control of my own life, pretty much. Like, I want to be, not only that, like, I want to be able to call the shots. Like, I want to decide when I'm a work or not. You know what I'm saying? So,
yeah,
I mean, that's what influenced me. And then, like I said, I have two young daughters. So when I had my first daughter born, she's 6 years old now. So 6 years old, or 6 years ago, was when I was like, okay, now I have to do this. Like, it's no longer an option. Mm-hmm. Like, I have to do this, because in order for me to have that freedom, that time, that financial space, that time with the kids, I have to work for myself. Like, I can't, you know, work 40 hours a week for somebody else, because that's a big chunk of time where I'm not doing other stuff that I can be doing. And also, like, I feel very adamant about being paid based off of merit versus the thing, like, when you work or whatever, like, if your pay is $20 an hour, you're going to get paid $20 an hour, like, no matter how hard or how little bit you work. Yeah. So I'm the type of person where if I work super hard, you have to pay me a lot.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So those three things, like, I wanted to be like, free in all aspects, financial, personal, family, my two daughters, because I want to be able to spend time with them. And then I also want to be able to train them to be able to start their own business too. So they, mm-hmm. you know, you never know, like, they're young. So 20 years from now, you don't know what the economic landscape is going to look like. So I want to teach them skills to be able to start their own stuff so they can be self-sufficient. And then, you know, like the last thing I said, like, dude, I want to be paid handsomely based on the amount of work. And not only that, like, being a consultant, like, you're helping other businesses. So if you're helping other businesses make money, why not, you know, reap some of that benefit also? So, you know, those are pretty much the three driving forces that inspired me to, like, go full steam ahead with the entrepreneur route.
Yeah, for sure. Those are three very good reasons. And one kind of interesting thing that I found is that there's kind of this thing, like, the baby effect that I've heard of. Not necessarily, like, baby, but, like, it seems that, like, entrepreneurs, when they have a kid or their kid hits a certain age, that, like, something clicks and they're like, whoa, like, I, like, have to do this and I have to make it work, because, like, you have somebody dependent on you, like, completely.
And exactly. And that's really real. Like, and you can really feel that too. Like, when mm-hmm. I'm with my kids, like, oh, like, they really depend on me. So, like,
yeah,
because, you know, obviously they're kids. Like, they don't know anything outside of, you know, being a child and, hey, this is my dad. So, you know, that like, innocence, it kind of, like, motivates me to, like, dude, like, they don't even understand, like, how hard I'm trying to make life so good for them. Like, and I can't let them down. Like, that's kind of, like, my feeling. Like, that's, like, the ultimate driver. Like, don't let these girls down. Mm-hmm. Don't let these girls down. Don't let these girls down. So, you know, it's a little bit of pressure, but, you know, some people work good under pressure, yeah. man. And I kind of learned to do that also. Mm-hmm. I would prefer, you know, not to always have to be under pressure situations, but, you know, when the pressure comes, you gotta just know how to meander that.
All right. So how did you learn what it takes to start a successful business? Like, in your past, what things had a role in that?
Pretty much, just, you know, going back to the mirror neurons, that I was talking about earlier, just the best way to learn something is to, one, go find people that have actually already done it, and two, actively try to do it. Like, I know a lot of people, you know, they'll go and, you know, oh, I want to start a business, you know, learning how to do SEO or something. And then they just buy, like, a whole gang of books and they read the books. Like, you know, reading the books are very valuable to get the knowledge, but you have to do the application part. Mm-hmm. Like, going back to sports, you know, because I'm a sports coach. So I always I refer to sports a lot because it's like it's my thing. So like, in order to get better at hitting the baseball, like, are you going to read a book or are you going to go to the batting cage and try to swing at the balls and learn how to hit the balls, right?
Uh-huh.
So, you know, same thing. Like, if you want to learn how to do SEO, like, do build a website and, like, you know, start writing blogs and, you know, start, like, you know, going to Google trends and all kind of stuff and try to, you know, lead traffic to your website. Application is one, but going back to the most important one is finding people that actually do what you're trying to do, and they've had some type of success at doing it. And then, you know, just ask them questions, like thousands of questions, like literally, like whatever question you could think of, like no matter how stupid you might think it is, ask it. Because, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs and a lot of people that have been in business for a long time, like, they're smart, you know, it might not be book smart, but they have the business savvy and the business smarts. So you're going to find out something that you had no clue about.
How can somebody who is an aspiring entrepreneur use a 9-to-5 job to help them learn the skills that they need to start a business?
You know, I would, that is the preferred method, is to, like I was saying earlier, is to actually, you know, work a job for, you know, a good time frame so that you can acquire a myriad of skills. Like, for instance, with AK3 Marketing, one of our services that we offer is email marketing. Mm-hmm. And I learned how to, you know, operate email marketing campaigns through working a 9-to-5 job. So, you know, I spearheaded the campaigns. You know, I learned how to do the messaging. I learned, how to do branding. I learned how to which type of content works best, how to increase, you know, company revenue by using email marketing. Working a 9-to-5 job is very valuable in that instance. Yeah, you know, work, gain that knowledge, gain those skills. And then at the same time, if you're thinking of a potential business to run, you know, try to, you know, relate what it is you're doing at your 9-to-5. How is that going to help you grow your business that you want to do?
Yeah, for sure. I think that working a 9-to-5 job in relation to kind of your aspirations of what you want to do as an entrepreneur is a great way to save money and learn the skills that you're going to need to use someday.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. For sure. And then also, like, another thing that's good about that is, unfortunately, some people, they go into business and then it ends up not being able to work for them. At least if you build up some type of resume that you have worked in corporate America and you have, you know, job experience, you know, it's good to have that, you know, because then, you know, you obviously going to have to go and get a job to make money to survive. So you want to have that on your resume as well. So work the 9-to-5, you know, gain the skills, gain the knowledge, learn how to navigate, like, you know, the corporate landscape and all that stuff. And then use everything that you learn on that job to apply to your business and how to grow and scale your business.
Yeah, for sure. And I think it adds a little bit of credibility when you do start your business as well. It gives you kind of a foundation.
Exactly, because when you're working and you're doing your 9-to-5 job, any type of projects that you're working on that you spearhead or whatever, save that. Like, for instance, for the email marketing, like, I have, like, all of my emails pretty much that we sent out saved. And then I have, like, the amount of orders, the amount of revenue that we made off of those. I have all those, like, saved as screenshots in my portfolio to, like, show, you know, clients when I'm trying to sell them my email marketing services. Like, okay, it's one thing to tell people that you can produce results for them, but I have to be able to show you too. Okay, these are the emails. This is what the emails consist of. This is the type of content. And by the way, this particular email made $5,000 in 48 hours. So yeah, they both go hand in hand for sure. Get that 9-to-5 work experience.
You made some great points there. So what is the most rewarding part about what you are doing in your businesses right now?
The most rewarding parts for me are, you know, actually providing results, you know, for people. That's one thing about me is I like to help people. And one thing about business also, when you guys do decide to, you know, go into business or whatever, try to think of a business an idea that's going to like solve problems, like try to solve issues for someone. So like, for instance, my personal training business, what am I doing? I'm solving problems for people that want to become more athletic. I can't jump high. I can't run fast. I'm out of shape. I need help. Okay, cool. I can help you. I have a solution. With my marketing, same thing. We need help promoting our business. We need to get more eyes on our company, on our products. So what do? We provide those services, email marketing. We do videos. We do Facebook advertisements, all kind of stuff like that. We provide help. We help people solve problems. And that, for me in particular, that intrinsic value is irreplaceable when it comes to doing your business.
Yeah, for sure. It seems like everybody has like a different aspect of the business that makes them feel rewarded and rewarding. And yeah, I think that you made a really good point there. So what is your top priority when it comes to your business?
My top priority would be, you would probably guess correctly if you took one guess. And that is the marketing aspect of it. Especially like starting out, like nobody knows who you are. So it's really hard to sell something when nobody knows who you are. So, you know, just doing the marketing and then doing the sales, marketing is the getting your brand or your service out and recognized so the public can recognize it and they know who you are and then what you do. And then the sales part is obviously, you know, trying to make the money to sustain the business and make the business grow.
Yeah.
So I would say actually both of those go hand in hand. Like those are my major priorities. And, and then also like just like producing the content, because the content is what is going to build that trust and that relationship with the people that you're trying to get to buy your stuff.
Sales and marketing are very important priorities in every business. You made a really good point there. And it's really interesting the ways that companies market nowadays. There's a lot of new, I guess, methods that they're taking advantage of. And the market seems to move fast in that area too.
Yeah. A lot of it is, you know, people are starting to become more utilitarian. So a lot of companies, what they're doing is, they're letting, if it makes sense, they're letting like the consumer like run the company now. Like I was saying earlier, like try to get feedback or try to get as much information as you can from the customer, because the customer dollar is what's going to make your business sink or swim. You feel what I'm saying? So always have your ear to the street and listen to what the customers are saying, because you have to cater to them. Like they're buying your stuff. So if you're just going to be like, yeah, I'm just going to do whatever I want, then guess what? That money is going to stop being spent with you, because this guy over here is actually listening to me and taking my input into consideration. And he's putting out products and services and value that benefits me. That's one thing that has really changed, especially like within the last 3 to 5 years, especially like influencer marketing on social media and stuff like that. Just your normal everyday person like has so much power. The business world now, making businesses sink or swim, is like really crazy.
Yeah. I really liked what you said there about how listening to the customer is really important, because I think that's probably one of the most important rules of business, is to listen to your customers and do what you can to shift towards what they are wanting, because they're in the end going to give you the money that you want. So
exactly. So you know, they say, they have the saying, the customer is always right. I don't say the customer is always right, but the customer dictates what you're going to do with your business pretty much.
Well, we're about halfway through the episode, so we're going to take a moment for a brief advertisement. Over the past few months, podcasting is something that I've become very passionate about. It's helped me open many doors to new relationships, new networking opportunities, and giving the opportunity to share other people's knowledge and grow my personal brand, as well as have a lot of fun. Whether you're looking for a new marketing channel, have a message you want to share with the world, or just think it would be fun to have your own talk show, podcasting is an easy, inexpensive, and fun way to expand your reach online. Buzzsprout is hands down the easiest and best way to launch, promote, and track your podcast. Your show can be online and listed in all the major podcast directories like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and more within minutes of finishing your recording. Now, I have a special offer for all of the listeners here on the Student Built Startups podcast. following the link in the show notes lets Buzzsprout know we sent you gets you a $20 Amazon gift card if you sign up for a paid plan and helps support our show. Podcasting isn't hard when you have the right partners, and the team at Buzzsprout is passionate about helping you succeed. Join over 100,000 podcasters already using Buzzsprout to get their message out to the world. The link is in the show notes. What was your biggest fear when you first started your, I guess, entrepreneurial side of things, and how did you overcome that?
My biggest fear was, it was kind of twofold. Like, obviously, being on your own, like, not having that stability of a job, like, I'm having, like, a paycheck every week or 2 weeks, like, that is, like, that would scare anybody. Because, you know, you have that blanket of, okay, even if I don't have any money for like 5 days, at least I know I'm going to get paid with my check cashes on Friday. But when you're an entrepreneur and you depend on sales to make a living, like you may have a week where you sell everything. And then like the next week you make one or two sales and you're like, uh-oh, you know what I'm saying? Like then you start to look at like, you start to look at your expenses and your bills and like, okay, am I going to be able to do this? Right. So me, the way I overcame that was, I think at the time, like my rent where I live is like, it was like $800 a month or whatever. So my approach and my strategy was, okay, I have to just make at least $800 a month. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like just like being like a man, and this is like men stuff, but like just like being a man, like I kind of feel like I can't go back home and stay with my mom or my parents, or like I'm not gonna ask anybody can like sleep on their couch or anything like that. So I don't know if that's a pride thing or like an ego thing. I'm not gonna say ego. I'm not an egotistical guy or anything like that. But I had to make $800 a month just so I can keep my apartment. Like I didn't care like if I sat in my apartment like in the complete dark with no, you know what I'm saying? With no hot water and no food. Like as long as I have like my space where I can create, I'm good to go. Like I can go to my mom's house to eat, or like I can, you know, get on my bike or go wherever I need to go or whatever. And as far as like in my apartment, like if I didn't have any lights, that's cool. I just buy like a load of candles and like sit in the dark. And I have my cell phone, right? Like I could, like I actually like pictured that happening, and then I was like, "No, I can't let that happen either." Yeah. So that's what like drove me to like push, like to just try to make the bare minimum, just like starting out. Like all of that was scary. Not having, just worrying about not having money, and then like I said, I had my first daughter at the time, so like she was like just born.
Yeah.
So just like picture how scary that is. Like you have a kid and you are, you know, barely making your rent money and stuff like that. So it's really important to have like some type of a savings, guys. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Have like 6 months worth of savings, like not even just like your rent, but like all, like every expense that you have, your cell phone bill, your gas bill, if you have all that. Because, you know, and then that's one thing too. Like I didn't start a business. Just like, I didn't prepare myself. I had a job as a sales manager at a place that did SEO, as a matter of fact. And they were a startup, and they let me go because like I guess they didn't really need my position or whatever. And you know, I didn't expect that, dude. Like and I was only there for like 2 months. So, you know, you get a new job, like you don't expect to not have a new job in 2 months, right? Like, so I was still like just living like the basic everyday life, like, you know. Get my paycheck, pay my bills, pay money for entertainment, you know, all, you know, the stuff that regular people do. I didn't know, like, when I started the job, like 2 months from now, like you're going to be like all on your own with very little money saved, because I didn't have any money saved because I didn't plan to start a business like that soon. Like I kind of had to do it because I didn't have a job and I had to figure out how to make money, you know, like all that stuff drove me to stay on the track of trying to build business, dude, because like at the drop of a dime, like you could be at a job and they'll just say like, hey man, sorry, but we don't need you anymore. And you know, it's messed up and not messed up at the same time, because that's business. But when you think about it, dude, just think like in my situation, like I was gonna have a kid like in a month, you know what I'm saying? And then like just for like somebody to come tell you like, yeah, dude, your job is ending today. Like that's like very debilitating. So instead of like sinking into a shell, I kind of use that to like motivate me to like, dude, I can't depend on like just working all the time, because at the drop of a dime, like you can be fired and, oh, well, you just on your own, dude. Go make it happen.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I use that to go make it happen, dude. Like, I don't want this to happen to me again. So I'm just going to take matters into my own hands and build my own life. Those are the things that inspire me, dude. And that's what it's going to take to become an entrepreneur. Because like I said, it's very hard. It's very challenging. And giving up is very easy. You got to have something that's going to just like keep you going. Like, I don't want to go back to work. I don't want to go back to work. I don't want to go back to work. Like, that's like always my thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that keeps me going. Even though the hardships are there or whatever, that's what keeps me going. Like, I have to keep this freedom that I have, dude.
One point you made that was really good was the saving, having like at least 6 months of savings. It's almost staggering how many people in America don't have even like 1 or 2 months of like savings saved for like an emergency. And when you do have that savings there, it definitely will like relieve some of the pressure.
Exactly. And the thing about that is like during that time, like after I got laid off of that 2 month job I had, dude, like there was a period of time where I didn't have a dollar. Like, I literally didn't have a dollar in existence at all. Like I couldn't go to a bank, to my bank, and say, hey, can I get a dollar out of my account? Like, this is no BS, dude. And, you know, it's kind of funny now when I look back at it, because that's the depths that I'm willing to go to, like, not have any money at all. And like, just, I can't leave home because I can't buy anything. You know what I'm saying? Is, you know, that's what it's going to take sometimes to, you know, if you really want to do this and you really want this to be your life, you know, you got to be willing to sacrifice. And a lot of people aren't. And, you know, you can't really blame them, because that's tough, man. It's tough to not have money at all. Like, but you got to have an abundance mindset, and you got to think long term. And one thing about me, I have the utmost confidence in my abilities to do stuff. So I don't never, I mean, there were times where the doubt came in and like, I don't want to do this anymore. But like, even when I told myself that, like when the next day came, what did I do? I like got right back on my laptop and like started where I finished off the next day, because this is just who I am. Like, I have this mentality of like, when I start something, I'm gonna commit to it, and I have to get the results that I'm looking for.
Thanks for sharing that. That's pretty crazy how you went from no dollars right after you lost that job, and then still had the ambition to go and continue working on your businesses and use that as kind of a driving force.
Yeah, true story, man. True story.
Yeah.
So you got to be, like I said, you got to be willing to be very uncomfortable, and that's like the worst. You know, I mean, I can't think of anything worse than that. I mean, I'm sure there's something, but you know, just not being able to go to McDonald's and have $2 to buy some cheeseburger, like, one, it's embarrassing, and two, it's just like, I'm not about to do this anymore, dude. So I gotta make this happen that I'm trying to do. So
yeah. So we're gonna jump into talking a little bit about content creation and marketing a little bit more in depth. So start off with, why is creating content so important when it comes to marketing your business?
I think I mentioned it briefly earlier, but you know, creating content is pretty much your way of introducing yourself to the public.
Mm-hmm.
You feel what I'm saying? So you have a business idea that you think is great. It's going to make me $10 million. And then you go and you come to find out that, hey, like, dude, nobody knows you at all. And nobody knows you. They're not going to spend their money with you. Like, I don't care if it's $5 that you're asking for or whatever. So, you know, creating contact is multifaceted. It's one, you know, trying to get your name out there, trying to get that visibility. Two, you want to be able to put your expertise on display. Like, hey, this is what I do. This is my knowledge. My knowledge and the stuff that I do can help you. Okay. So that's the second part. And then, you know, the third part is just that, like posting, you know, results that you've gotten from things that you've done. You know, it's a three-pronged approach. Introduce yourself with content. It could be anything, blogs, videos, you know, anything. Showcase what you are, what you do and who you are. And then three, like, okay, these are the type of results I can get you. Like, that's like the mini funnel that, you know, content creation is. Introduction phase, what I do and how I can help you. So, you know, creating content, you know, it's hundreds of ways to create content. So anytime you're getting stuck about what you can create, you can volleyball back and forth between anything. One thing that I've worked for me, especially when I started out with my sports training, was I started writing blogs on these like coaching websites about like specific workouts and what the benefits are.
Yeah.
And once those got published, like random people just like start reaching out to me. And like, that's what I mean. Like just telling people what you know, like you'll be surprised how many people don't even know like the basic stuff of like, for instance, like working out or whatever, like how many people don't know the basics of like health and working out, or even like with the marketing side of it, like how many people don't even know how to like hook up Google Analytics like to their website or something like that. Like it sounds like very difficult, but it's really easy to do. It's like a real simple copy and paste job. Like, and you know what I'm saying? And just writing stuff like that, it makes you look relevant. It makes you look like you're insightful. It makes like you know what you're talking about. So, you know, blogs work for me real well. And then like videos obviously work real well. Like people would rather watch a video than like read a book. So, you know, you with your podcasting, you probably do like blog or vlogging or something like that. Like people, you know, especially if you're interesting, you got good stuff to say, like they'll just sit around and see what you have to say. Now it has to be interesting and it has to be helpful in order for people to stick around and engage. But just like think about how many times like you've been walking past the TV, minding your own business, and then like a snazzy like commercial or something comes on and then you just like stop to watch it for a minute. That's the importance of content. Just like getting people aware of who you are, you know, letting them know what you do and then letting them know how you can help them. And then hopefully from that point, at some point in your marketing funnel, you could turn them into customers.
Yeah, for sure. You did a great job of breaking down kind of the three prong approach there with like blog posts, that kind of stuff, kind of getting your name out there and then displaying kind of your expertise and then kind of how you can help. How does marketing differ from advertising and kind of what are the advantages of each there?
That's funny because I was just talking about this yesterday. So marketing is like the umbrella, and then like advertising is a part of marketing. So marketing is pretty much like, think of it as, okay, we have a product or a service or whatever. Now we have to figure out how we're going to introduce it. Like one, how we're going to price it, how we're going to introduce it, how we're going to make this like survive long enough to make some money off it or whatever. So marketing is pretty much like, for lack of a better term, like the introduction of your product to the marketplace. It also, very important, I skip a couple of things. Very important, it involves a lot of research and a lot of data collection. Because or you have a product and service, now you got to know, like, is it even a use for it? Like, do people even need this, whatever it is? And two, if the people need it, great. Now, who are these people and where do we find them? And then that is where advertising comes in. Okay, so we got a product and service. We found out it's useful. People need it. We found out people 25 to 34 need it. They're going to probably be located near a beach town or something like that. You know, whatever your analytics and your data is. OK, so now the advertising comes in as this, pretty much think of it as like the paid approach. So it's now you're applying the data and the research that you got in the marketing part from it. And now you're using that to broadcast it out to the public. So like I said, you know, you got a product or service, you got this is just an example, 25 to 34 that lives in beach cities. Say your product is like surfboards or something like that. So obviously you're not going to sell surfboards in Nebraska. Okay. So, you know what I'm saying? So that's the marketing phase. So now the advertising phase is, okay, we know we're not going to sell anything to anybody in Nebraska. So we're not even going to advertise. We're not even going to waste any money, you know, like investing in what? It's like Facebook ads or Google ads or whatever. We're not even gonna think about Nebraska. Yeah. Because, you know, the data says that would be stupid. So the advertising comes, you know, the advertising is just pretty much applying the data that you used in the marketing phase in order to attract who it is that you're trying to go after and make them purchase.
Yeah, cool. I'm a big fan of doing your research before you go into marketing a product and using your data. Right now I'm studying marketing analytics at UMD. So
okay, yeah. You're a smart dude, then, man. Yeah, yeah. I'm a research guru myself, dude. I like digging and you know, searching for stuff and seeing what it is that I found, seeing, you know, if it will be useful, like how can I use it to do something?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So yeah, that's pretty much what marketing is. It's researching and data just to see if what it is that you're trying to sell is even useful, mm-hmm. and would it make you any money.
Yeah, it's rewarding when you find something that does help you out too.
yeah, for sure. You definitely want to come up with something that's going to make money. Like, obviously, guys, like when you go into business, like you want to make money. And I would say don't even aspire to be rich. Just be able to aspire to be financially stable where you don't have to go work a job. Like, you feel what I'm saying? Like, if you come up with a business and you make like $60,000 a year, would you rather work for yourself and make $60,000 a year or go to a job like every day at 8 o'clock in the morning, making $60,000 a year? Like, I'm sure everybody would be like, yeah, I'll just work at home in my PJs for $60,000 a year. So, if you happen to strike it rich and be real wealthy, great. I'm happy for you. And I'm cheering you on to do so. But, you know, if you make it to, you know, like I said, 50,000-60,000 and you can live off of that, then you're good.
Mm-hmm.
You're good. You know, just at least keep that up and then just always continue to try to scale, because there's always ways that you can make more money.
Absolutely. How does someone with a creative idea, or how can someone with a creative idea come up with a plan or strategy to kind of turn that from just an idea into a business? And what are kind of three general things that should be included in their kind of strategy?
You want to, if you're trying to start a business, try to think of something, like I said earlier, something that's going to solve a problem. Like, try to solve a problem or help somebody, like whether it be like get more customers, produce winter coats for the winter or whatever, something that solves some type of a problem. And then figure out who your audience is. It's pretty much like the same steps as I explained, like with the content creation part. So you want to, you know, come up with a product or a service that's going to solve a problem, figure out who needs it, and then figure out how to connect with those particular people. You know what I'm saying? And then once you do that, you have to try to just kind of retain those people. Most of your business is going to come off your the 80-20 rule. 80% of your business come from 20% of your people. So you want to always retain. You want to definitely retain the business that you keep, guys. Like, don't just have people buy stuff from you one time and be like, okay, I got their money, they're good. And that's one good thing about like email marketing. I'm a big proponent on email marketing. That's why it's one of the services that I offer.
Yeah.
Email marketing is good. And I'm sure you're part of a whole lot of email lists. Like I am. I get like a ton of emails like at 3 o'clock in the morning because I'm a part of so many email lists. But, you know, that's how you retain your people, guys. Like, they buy something from you, cool, but always keep them in the loop. Like, we have more stuff to buy, or not even like, don't always press them to buy stuff from you, but like just send them information. Like, for instance, with my sports training, you know, part of my emails are just like, remember, guys, you know, it's recommended that you get 30 minutes of activity a day. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to sell anything. I'm just connecting with the people that I've already have come in contact with. And I'm trying to, you know, either build stronger relationships with the people who our relationships are okay, or, you know, maintain the relationships with the people that we have good relationships to have them to keep coming. And then like the colder guys, that the colder leads on your list or whatever, that, you know, they may have never bought anything from me before, but they subscribe to your list. They subscribe to your list for something, like you provide some sort of value. So keep those people in contact. So then eventually you're going to wear on them. Like, okay, I've been a part of this guy's email list for like a year. Like, he has a lot of good content. Like, he has a book, he has blogs. Like, he knows what he's doing. Let me go and see how he can help me solve a problem.
Yeah, that was great there. I'm a big fan of email marketing as well. I think a lot of people say it's, you know, quote, dead, but I think it's honestly like one of the most steady ways of marketing, because you have complete control over that.
Yeah, I actually think it's the best, dude, because mm-hmm. like you said, you have complete control. And think about it, like, unless a person like changes their email, like, you have contact with them pretty much for the rest of their life.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I've been on email list for like 5 years, like 7 years. And sometimes I see them come through and I'm like, dude, why the hell am I even still a part of this email list? But like, I don't unsubscribe because like I subscribe for a reason. Like the information that they're providing is useful. Like the important thing about email marketing is like the subject line. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like you got to have a hell of a subject line to make people like open your email. You don't want like basic, like for instance, like we have a restaurant out here, a seafood restaurant called like Red Lobster or whatever. So like every so often they'll send like, hey, we have discounts on lunch, 10% off, whatever. I'm like, that don't really move the needle or whatever. Yeah. But now if you see an email subject from somebody like a marketer that says like, here's the template of how I made $30,000 in one day. You're going to open that, right?
Yeah.
Like, $30,000 in one day. Like, what are you talking about? Like, you know what I'm saying? So, email marketing, like people say it's dead because it's just like it's more crowded. The space is more crowded, but you can meander your way around, dude. It's just all about creativity.
Yeah.
It's all about creativity and just knowing how to communicate with the people that you're looking to get in contact with.
Yeah, for sure. You made some great points there. And I think, yeah, you said the subject line is very important because, yeah, I mean, if they don't open the email, well.
Yeah, it just falls on deaf ears. If they don't open the email, like, I mean, but then even then, like I said, the worst case scenario is you still have somebody on your email list and you still have mm-hmm. somebody you can send stuff to. So, it is what it is.
Yeah, for sure. So what are some things that small business owners should avoid doing when they're trying to market their business or product?
One thing I would avoid doing is like trying to rely heavily on one like medium or like one channel. Like for instance, at one of the Facebook groups I'm in, I like to, that's part of my marketing too, is like in those Facebook groups, I just like try to get a gauge for what people are saying and how they think about certain stuff. So I'll post like, well, one day in particular, I posted what marketing challenges do you have or something like that? Or like, how do you market your product? I don't remember exactly. But what I do remember was like most of the responses were like people say they market their product by like posting on social media. And like, that's it. Like, dude, you can't just only post on social media. Like, you only have 1,000 followers or whatever. Like the number of followers doesn't matter to me. You know what I'm saying? Like my social media following isn't hell of a big. I kind of pride myself more on like the actual work and the results mm-hmm. that I provide, like not like the followers. But if you're just posting on social media, like the only people that see your stuff are the people that follow you. And like after a while, they're going to become numb to that because they see it all the time. So why not spend some money on Google Ads, Facebook Ads or whatever, or invest in email marketing, build your list so that you can constantly send out information with the Facebook ads, like in particular, like spend that money due to like go after your marketing research and your data that you got, like the 25 to 34 people that live by the beach. Hey, you need to spend money to make ads to go directly over to those people. You know what I'm saying? Like nobody on your social media or your Instagram page is like interested in search boards, just like going by that example that we used earlier or whatever. So don't just rely on one channel. Like, don't just rely on social media marketing. Don't just rely on email marketing. Like, get on YouTube. Like, you know what I'm saying? If you have valuable content or valuable stuff that you can share, like if you're a chef or something, get on YouTube and like record yourself like making like a cake or something like that. Like, just create the content, dude. And, get creative. That's all it is. Like, get creative. Don't get stale and don't just rely on just one thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. I really liked what you said there about don't rely on one thing, because like with the social media thing, like you may have 1,000 followers. Let's say somebody has that many and they may not even, I don't know, who knows how many people are actually receiving it on their feed with the algorithms and stuff. So
exactly. Like I have followers on my page that I'm sure they've never liked any one of my posts or anything. They probably never even looked at any of my content. So, or anything, like it's better to spend money on advertisements for people that actually want your stuff, or, build your email list. So the people that are interested, like you can always just keep them in the loop.
Yep.
And then you're sending it right to them, like to their email. Like, they don't have to go find it. Like I sent it to your phone. Like, dude, your Google, your Gmail just went off. I have shit to give you. Like, open it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, don't rely on one thing, dude, because that's going to burn out. And then when people start to get burned out, there's like, oh, dude, this isn't working anymore. I give up. You feel what I'm saying? You see how that all ties into each other.
Yep. Yep.
So just be creative with your marketing. Utilize all channels that you can. For instance, when I saw you mention a potential guest for the podcast, I was like, hell yeah, I'll get on that. Why? Because I need more content, right? And even more so, you need more content.
Yep.
No, it's like it's a give thing. So I was more than happy to, you know, help you out and then also help myself out because, you know, I need the content. So
we got one more question before we move on to the fast five. What is like one tip that you can provide about email marketing in specific?
When you start your business and you get your niche and you niche yourself out, learn how those people talk. You know what I'm saying? Learn the verbiage that they use, learn the language that they use. So then you can placate that and you can tailor your messaging, your email messaging to that. And then lastly, utilize different content, utilize not just photos, but utilize videos, you know, utilize GIFs, put links in there to your social media, because then they'll, you know, you'll create that tribe, that brand, you know, that following. Know how to target people, learn how to retarget people that open your emails. Those are people that are more likely to buy your stuff. When you are selling something, you want to be able to target those people that open your emails the most. I wouldn't say it doesn't make sense to send it to your whole list. And everything is always a learning process too, guys. Like, never stop learning and never feel like you just know everything. Always go and look for like any type of tips or any type of help that you can get from somebody that's better than you, quote unquote, or has been doing it a little bit longer. You know, get help from them. And then, you know, you don't have to do exactly what it is, but at least get tidbits so you can use your own creativity to kind of spark your ideas and keep it fresh.
Yeah. Everything's a learning game. You can always learn.
Everything is a learning game. And dude, like, that's like, your knowledge is your best asset. We're going to get older and, you know, less attractive and stuff like that. Like, your look's going to fade, but like everything that you know, like, I do. I know a whole gang of shit. Like, you can't tell me anything. Like, I just know everything. You know, you can leverage that knowledge into business and making money. Like, going back to my personal training business, like, after a while, I just recently, like, at the end of last year, I wrote a book, like, How to Become a Better Athlete with like, different templates in there, like, different workouts, because I built up that knowledge of 6 years of training. 6 years of training and, like, 15 years of actually playing sports. So I had the knowledge. And I just leverage that knowledge to create content that will make, you know, passive income.
Yeah, for sure. Well, we're going to move on to the fast five section. What is the most valuable class or course that you have taken?
Actually, two things. I don't remember what class this was, but I went into marketing because one thing that stuck out to me was my professor. He said three fields you can go into where you can always like either get a job or always make money. And he said accounting, finance, and marketing. So I was like, well, accounting and finance is out because I'm not counting. No, like, I'm not doing any math. Right. I'm like, I'm not doing any math. I hate math. Like, I'm staying away from that. So I'm like, yeah, marketing is, I can do marketing. Like, I'm pretty creative. Like, I like to make up stuff. And like I said, do research and data collection, data analysis and stuff. So then I decided to go into marketing. So then when I went to Cal State Fullerton, my favorite class there was actually, it was sports marketing. I don't know if that was like the actual name of the class, but it's pretty much sports marketing. In that class, I learned a lot about like the marketing side of sports. Like, it was something that I never thought of. You have a business side of the sport, or obviously you have the sports side and you have the business. Like, the marketing team of like the Minnesota Timberwolves, like, they have to put like those events together. And then like the shirts that they leave on the seats and stuff like that. So I was like, oh, damn, that's cool as hell, man. Like, oh, I never looked at sports in that light. It was kind of like from that point is when I was like trying to figure out like, okay, how can I marry the two? And then I eventually did so with my sports training, did sports. And then I had to obviously do marketing. And then later on, after I gained that experience of marketing not only my business, but working in marketing, I was like, I'm just going to be a marketing consultant because I've had success in doing that. So, you know, and it's something that I like doing, you know, I like helping people. So, yeah.
All right. Question number two, what is one book that you would recommend?
48 Laws of Power. 48 Laws of Power by David Greene. It's a self-help book. I don't know, you might or might not have heard of it, but if not, at least Google it and read it. It's just like 48 laws that are pretty much like help you with your everyday life. It's not a business book. It's just like a self-help book. So I suggest that for reading when you want like self-improvement and stuff like that.
Awesome. I'll have to check that out. So question number three, what is one business tool that you would recommend?
Email, guys. Email, all right? Email. MailChimp. I use MailChimp for my email marketing. Another thing I would say is, I think I mentioned it earlier in the cast, is like Google Analytics. When you have a website, hook up Google Analytics. That way you can know where your traffic is coming from. And then that will help you tailor your marketing and your advertising strategy a little bit.
Yeah, Google Analytics is very, I mean, if you don't have it set up, you're missing out.
Yeah, I love Google Analytics, man. I look at it for like 10 minutes. That's like the first thing. I check my emails, then I go to Google Analytics like every morning. Like, that's like the first two things I do.
Question number four. So how do you schedule your time and plan ahead?
Well, pretty like Monday through Friday, like all my time is like pretty much accounted for. So I have to schedule my time to stay organized. So I'll wake up in the morning. Like, this is like a typical day for me. Like, I'll just wake up. I like to do meditating in the morning. Sometimes I do so while I'm taking like a hot bath so I can kind of get relaxed. Then I go to the gym for about an hour and a half. Then I come home and then I work on whatever the most pressing thing is at that time. I work for a few hours. And then, most of the time in the evening is when I work on my training clients. And then after that, at night, I'll do like some educational stuff. Like, I'll learn something. I'll like watch something on YouTube or like read something about SEO or Google Analytics or some type of marketing. Or if I'm just burnt out on that stuff, I'll just, like I said, I'll read something that's like personally beneficial for me.
Yeah, for sure. All right. So our last question here, how do you get focused and stay productive?
Pretty much with that daily routine, dude. Like, yeah. I do it every day. So that's how I focus myself. The meditation, the bath, and the workout, like, that does it. You know, just staying focused, you know, that's an issue. That's an issue that some people may have. And even like I have it sometime where I'm focused and then I drift out. Everybody's motivated differently. So I just try to keep in mind, like, why am I doing this? And, you know, at the end of the day, I'm helping somebody else. And then that's going to also help me. So, you know, that's just how I stay focused. And then I like to work in spurts anyway. So like I said, I'll work for 3 hours. I have to do X, Y, and Z in this 3 hour period.
Yeah. I use a very similar process.
yeah, exactly.
Well, Jared, you gave some great insights and information, about marketing and content creation, email marketing. You shared your awesome story, so I'm really, really glad that you were able to be on here and do that. But before we wrap up, I'll ask you to provide one main takeaway that you'd like everyone to remember.
One main takeaway is, like I said, guys, you know, help people, learn from people, and don't give up. That's like the three hardest things when it comes to like entrepreneurship that like people overlook. Like I said, come up with a business idea where you're going to help people. When you decide to go in business, find people that have done it before that can help you get better. And then don't ever give up. I mean, don't ever give up. There are going to be lows, guys. There's going to be times where you're like, man, F this. I'm not doing this anymore. I guarantee it. Don't let that moment of dismay derail you from the ultimate goal. Like, always try to remember why you started and where you want to be in 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years.
Yeah, that's a great, great main takeaway. Keep your eyes on the prize. So where can we find more about you and your businesses?
You can find me on all the major social media networks, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, AK3 Marketing. That's for my marketing consultant business. We're actually doing a promotion right now, too, guys, where we'll create you a logo and then we'll create an animated logo for you. So we're doing that. Or if you have a logo already, shoot us the logo and we'll animate it for you. And then you can use that for your social media. You can use that for your YouTube intros, your podcast intros. Or if you guys run like ads on Google and Facebook, you know, just to, get people's attention and help them engage with your content. So we have that promo going on now. As far as my sports training, my private sports coaching business, Steel Bodies University, that's STEELE, like the last name Steel Bodies University, like the college. And that's on all the same things. Facebook, well, Instagram is Steel Bodies _U, the letter U. And then for you guys on Twitter, it's just at SteelBodies. I don't really use Twitter that much for my training. I kind of just really follow that for like the sports news and to like talk to people that I'm friends with in sports. Follow me on there. We will engage, and you might find some useful content. Some of you guys that are athletes out there. So yeah, follow both AK3 Marketing. If you guys need logo help, I don't know. My email is ak3marketing@gmail.com. You guys can reach out to me there, and we'll be happy to hook you guys up and get you guys going with building your brand.
Awesome. Thanks for being on the show, Jared.
Appreciate you, man. Appreciate you.
I'm really glad that I got to share Jared's story with all of you. Thanks again for being on the show, Jared. And thanks to everyone listening right now. I truly appreciate your support on this journey. Make sure to hit that subscribe button, leave a review on Apple Podcasts, and share this episode with a friend. I encourage you to go check out studentbuiltstartups.com for the show notes for this episode, including all of the links, all of the things that we mentioned, including the special Buzzsprout offer for all of you guys listening right now. Make sure to take advantage of that offer. Thanks again, and I'll catch you on the next episode.